try to posit the entire issue of the freedom to dissent with the complete impunity and immunity with which society and state has begun to regard hate speech. Because I think the two things are intrinsically linked. If you're looking at the culture of amnesia that this current regime embodies, the culture of forced amnesia that we are all being forced into by the existence of the current regime, then I think we need to just look very closely at the very intense 6 weeks of campaign hearing and almost 1.5 years of the build-up to that campaign, where it came to extremely vicious, hard-hitting hate speech that managed to criminalize the atmosphere and polarize the electorate, and which we are being now told happens at election time and we should be forgetting. I think we fall into the trap of also allowing this to happen. I'd just like to flag a few of the most crass instances, first by the current Prime Minister himself when he spoke at Sirampur on the border of Bangladesh, West Bengal and Assam, when he said that just wait till May 16th and all Bangladeshis will be chucked out of India. I'm not even repeating what the Jharkhand person said, or the one who said in Mumbai when Modi was on the dais, when they spoke about what would happen to dissenters and which country they will be sent off to. I think it's extremely important, if we are talking to agitate, to preserve the freedom to dissent, that we agitate to prosecute the hate speech that went into the election campaign and not allow it to be part of the public amnesia that we are told to do. The 2014 BJP manifesto is an extension of Golwalkar's We Are Our Nationhood Defined, that makes rightly people like John Dayal extremely worried about the basic issue of citizenship. The manifesto openly said that Hindus are welcome here. I quote, that India shall remain a natural home for persecuted Hindus and they shall be welcome to seek refuge here. If that is the case, and that is the extension to which you then connect the speech made in West Bengal, Assam. And let's not forget, the speech was not made in isolation. It resulted in deaths and attack on Muslims. And that entire episode, because it's happening in Congress-ruled Assam, is pushed below the carpet. The kind of hate speech indulged by sections of the Bodo outfit, some in alliance with the Tarun Gogoi government and some not, I also need examination here. And the attacks on certain Facebook users post-elections, all attacks by police of the state where the BJP is not in power. Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Goa. Goa is the only one where the BJP is in power. And there, because of a strong agitation by citizens, Devu was prevented from being arrested. But in all other cases, whether the SFI activists in Kerala or Vakhar in Bangalore, who's a management graduate, who apparently did this visual depiction of the Antim Sanskar of the Modi government, was forced to be arrested. There is an absence of a cohesive intervention by any groups. Political parties, as they exist, the opposition political parties have been quite silent on these attacks on freedom of expression. And I find that quite telling, that the real task for a group like this and for the many others that we represent is how we reclaim not just the idea of India, but reclaim and make very assertive the notion of secularism. Secularism as complete neutrality by the state and respect for pluralism, as has been reiterated since the morning. But we need to emphasize neutrality by the state in terms of governance, in terms of judicial decisions, in terms of police action, in terms of education in textbooks. And if we fail to make this link between the neutrality of the state while respecting and celebrating our diversity and pluralism, I think we'll be not reclaiming secularism as is the need of the hour. Why are the opposition political parties still in a state of shell-shock silence and are not able to articulate issues of freedom and dissent is something we need to push a response out of the political class. One very, very heartening image for me on the 17th of May, when that pretty ghastly Ganga Aarti was being performed in Banaras, was Nitish and Lalu capturing the headlines, and they continue to capture them because of an attempt at reworking alliances. And I think this is what we need to build and push as political activists. that this cannot be a time for independent disparateness. This is a time to somehow come together at whatever broad platform level politically to take on the monster that we have installed in power. Another phenomenon as a media person I'd like to observe about the televised election campaign is that towards the last 4 or 5 weeks, electronic media was not allowed to cover independently events, and BJP feeds were given. BJP and RSS feeds were the only source of media information. The rallies in Amethi, particularly by the Prime Minister incumbent at the time, the Ganga Aarti that took place on 17th of May was not independently covered by channels. It was only BJP media feed that was given to the media, and they were carrying the official version of the party now in power. What does this mean for the independence of the media? A young writer from Banaras called me in great agitation to say something which I had not noticed, that the camera kept focusing on that part of the Vishwanath Mandir which is supposed to be under dispute, not open to television cameras. And yet, that is the image that was boomed out when the aarti was being performed at Vishwanath Mandir. There is a sinister game plan at play. It's not simply about reconstructing the state, but also possibly extremely controversial and conflict-ridden acts will take place over places of worship. There has been an attempt by several Andhra Pradesh mutts to buy over land around the Kashi Vishwanath Mandir, something that has been happening over the last 12 to 15 years. Some of us are collecting documents on this. And there is no question that the administration there, regardless of which party it represents, has plans for a grand temple at the likes of Tirupati to be rebuilt, where all the dirt around, quote-unquote, dirt around the existing temple is cleaned up. So there are several levels of the challenge before us. Politically, we know what we face. In terms of judiciary, I think I'd like to flag that that's not the subject matter of discussion directly, but I think it fits squarely into the issue of dissent, that if you're talking about the independence of the judiciary, already the writing is clearly on the wall, clearly on the wall. Among the persons who have been appointed as the top law officers of the country are those lawyers who defended the Gujarat government post-2002 at the most critical periods, in all the cases that we were on the opposite side, with lawyers whom we could not even pay fees, you had these persons being paid from the state exchequer. Mukul Rohatgi is today's Attorney General. He would ask only for a chartered plane. He never went by commercial aircraft, and his fees were 60 lakhs a day. 60 lakhs a day is the fees he charged. We managed to get an RTI done for what the SIT counsel in the Zakia Jafri case is now going to be paid, which says that the top Supreme Court counsel is going to be paid 9 lakhs a day in the Zakia Jafri case. We are able to pay Sanjay Parikh, Kamini Jaiswal and Mihir Desai, Aparna Bhatt simply an airfare and a residency at the sports club, which my dear friend Suyal Kirmizi is a member of. We don't pay them any fees for the matter. We do all the preparatory work and they argue the cases. But the Gujarat taxpayer will now be paying 9 lakhs a day in the Zakia Jafri case to defend SIT and defend Modi and 59 others. The fact that this government has got no time nor sees no need for the niceties of judicial independence is very, very clear from the recent controversy around the appointments to the Supreme Court. And it's very, very clear what they're going to do bottom upwards. And as John said, that they are looking at a long-term plan. They're not looking at one individual in power. They are looking to actually consolidate their base for the next 10 to 15 years. Two areas, I think, where maybe we are weak in terms of a group that is present in this hall are rural areas, tribal areas. A book I happen to edit where Professor Archana Prasad has done a wonderful paper on allocations to tribal ministries finds that even under the previous UPA regimes, particularly the 7.5 years, maximum allotments and from the central tribal ministries have gone to the VHP and RSS sponsored projects in Gujarat, in Chhattisgarh and in Madhya Pradesh. So it's happened long before they took political power. It'll happen only more now, as we've seen the appointment of ICHR chief yesterday, Mr. V. Sudarshan Rao, who apparently is a great doyen of ancient Hindu culture, and which is why he's been appointed. I think we need to look at monitoring the media very carefully. Press Council of India and Editors Guild because there's a complete abdication of media responsibility when it comes to these attacks on freedom that Anand mentioned, others mentioned, and that I just flagged just now. If there was one thing that broke the euphoria, even the euphoria that people like Rajdeep Sardesai and Nikhil Wagle were creating after Bal Thackeray's death, you remember he was made into a whole martyr and a hero and the funeral. The only thing that punctured it was the arrest of Shaheen and her friend at Padga. And that was blown completely on television channels day after day and night after night. You see no coverage of that sort on the Facebook arrests. You see no such coverage on any of the attacks that have taken place post May 16th. So there is a self-censorship in place. There's a fear in place. There's a imposed public amnesia which is in place. We are not supposed therefore to talk not about 2002, but we are not supposed to talk about 94 to 1999, the period of the NDA government, which I'd much rather do, because I think we're talking about systemic issues. And if you're talking about systemic issues, you're not talking about one individual, then we must need to look at what the previous NDA government, far weaker than this one, did in the area of culture and education. Therefore, we are looking at long-term damage. Tribal ministry and Panchayati Raj ministry is going to be crucial to the area for attack, because I think they're looking to consolidate their 31% close to 40%. Once they reach a 40%, they're virtually undislodgeable for the next conceivable 20 to 30 years. So it's a huge challenge, and I think it's a huge challenge not just for political parties, but for all of us activists who don't have the luxury anymore of just working as individual groups doing excellent work. But like Mallika said, we better get our act together and reach out there and say how many hours of every day are we going to spend collectively and differently from what we've been doing in the past, so that maybe we achieve a different result. Thank you very much.